Hey there, everybody. Welcome once again to Sea of Tranquility's Best Albums of the Year show. I am your host, Pete Pardo, publisher and CEO of SOT. Today is Christmas Day, Christmas morning, actually, December the 25th, 2017. So last week we were in Rock Fantasy in Middletown, New York, where I talked about my picks 11 through 20. Okay, if you go on our website right now, you can see all the top 50 picks of mine from this year, as well as the rest of our staff. But today we're going to focus on my top 10 releases of 2017. So, you know, a lot of really good stuff came out this year. My original list that I basically compiled throughout the year had well over 100 albums on there. So if there's a band or artist out there that got reviewed pretty highly on Sea of Tranquility this year and you didn't see yourself in the top 10 or 20, please look at my larger list and you'll get to see all my top picks of the year. But obviously I couldn't include everybody. I wish I could. But you know, if you sat pretty well on my list this year based on my review. So there's a lot of stuff that I really enjoyed this year. But let's get to that top 10. So coming in at number 10, this is an album by a band that I like quite a bit. They've actually got a lot of really strong releases. And again, they're one of these growing list of really, really top Swedish 70s-style hard rock bands. And I'm talking about Sienna Root. A Dream of Lasting Peace is their brand new one. This is a sensational album. I think probably their best. It's a little different. So, you know, these guys have done like kind of like that Deep Purple, Uriah Heep, Black Sabbath kind of hard rock thing. They blend little elements of like, say, Santana, as well as kind of like a bluesy rock type of thing, a little bit of psychedelia. I like this album a lot. It's got really strong vocals. It's got great Hammond organ and keyboards, really ripping guitar work. Just a really, really, really enjoyable album. And a band that I think, you know, given the right circumstances, could be a really, really big hit worldwide. So if you have yet to discover Sienna Root, I highly recommend this one. One of the best Swedish bands going out there today comes in at number 10. Number 9, another Swedish band. It seems like this is year two in a row where a bunch of my top picks is kind of populated by Swedish bands. These guys have been around for a long time. They've been around since like the early, mid-80s. And kind of a pretty big band for a few years in the 80s. They had that huge hit, The Final Countdown, and Carry off the album Final Countdown. Kind of got lumped in with a lot of that kind of pop metal thing, hair metal that was going on back then. But, you know, this band was never really all about that. They actually began as a very, very good kind of throwback heavy rock band. You know, they've always been into like classic Deep Purple and UFO and Sabbath and that sort of thing. So after that kind of wave of popularity waned down a little bit, they really got serious and have actually put out a lot of really strong albums over the last 10 or 15 years. War of Kings, their last one, which came out a couple years ago, was one of my top picks of the year. And their latest, which is called Walk the Earth, is right up there for me as well, coming in at number 9. There's just some great songs on here. The title track is great. Oh boy, what else we got here? Election Day is a very strong tune. GTO, Haze, the lengthy epic at the end, Turn to Dust. Great vocals by Joey Tempest. Really, really great keyboards. I mean, this band kind of like a modern day, like Deep Purple meets Sabbath meets UFO. I hate to keep bringing those three bands up, but that's kind of where this band really got their influence from. John Norum, a guitarist, spectacular as always. Just a really, really strong album. Like I've said it in my review on the website, like I said it in the What's Hot show when I reviewed this. If all you know from Europe is The Final Countdown, and maybe you're not a big fan of that, just forget about that and investigate their last bunch of releases. I think you'll really enjoy them. Really, really great stuff. All right, that's number 9. Coming in at number 10, these guys are death metal legends. I don't think they've ever released a bad album, and their last couple have been just as strong as some of their early ones. And, you know, this to me is the best extreme metal album of the year. Well, let's narrow that down a little bit. The best death metal album of the year. It's called Atonement by the Mighty Immolation from New York. This is just, and it's on Nuclear Blast Records, this is just a crushing display of technical death metal ferocity from a band that just really never does a bad album, can do no wrong. Killer guitar riffs, it's just so heavy. The growling vocals are some of the best in the business. I mean, you know, the cover art kind of says it all. Just a, like I said, for me, the best death metal album of the year. A lot of good ones, but this just stood head and shoulders above everything else. So once again, Immolation, peaks at the top of my list yet again. Now we're going to go to, I believe we're at number 7, right? 10, 9, 8, 7, yes. Norwegian legends, right? Progressive metal, prog, folk, atmospheric kind of ambient music, and of course, black metal. I'm talking about the latest from Enslaved. It's called E, another fantastic album from these guys. That they just keep reinventing themselves over and over again. So, you know, they got the furious black metal, Viking metal, and then they do this kind of whole like Pink Floyd type of prog thing, bits of Genesis, and yes, they've got a new keyboard player who also sings all the clean vocals alongside bassist Grudel's growls and rasps. Fantastic job. Just great melodies, really heavy moments, some very progressive moments. It's like bits of, you know, it's black metal, 70s prog, space rock, all this kind of stuff. Kind of mixed in together. Wonderful album. Really, really good. So we're going to stay in Norway, but we're going to switch over to full-on 70s progressive rock here. This is a band who have been around for a little while. They've been around 15 years, I'm going to say, give or take. And they don't put out a lot of albums. You know, usually you can count on them every kind of 3, 4, or 5 years, maybe thereabouts. But when they do, they're spectacular. It's a complete throwback to the glorious sounds of the 70s. I'm talking about Wobbler. This is From Silence to Somewhere. You know, these guys are just really good at creating long, epic songs that are filled with like Moog and Mellotron and Hammond and Chamberlain and Taurus bass pedals, Rickenbacker bass, guitar, acoustic guitar, you know, electric and acoustic guitar, really great vocals, just all the classic prog instrumentation, but the long songs are never boring. They're always engaging. The musical interplay is just fantastic. I think this is, could be their best album, and this is a band who every release they have, and they don't have a lot of them, it's only a handful of them, have been excellent. As far as like, you know, Norwegian prog, modern Norwegian prog goes, doesn't get much better than these guys. That's them right there. And just love great analog classic keyboards and killer arrangements. Yeah, if you're a fan of like Gentle Giant and Yes and Genesis and King Crimson and Vandegrift Generator and all those bands, this is the deal. Probably my favorite, I think my favorite prog album of 2017. All right, so that's number 7. I'm going to go to number 6. Now, the interesting thing about what you're going to see kind of here going forward, there's a couple of these albums here that I knew from right from the get-go that they were going to wind up in the top, 5 or so. And that indeed was the case, but it was just a matter of where would they lay at the very end when I actually had to pick which one was better than the other. Not an easy choice. And a couple of latecomers to the game kind of threw this whole thing for a loop. But all of these albums for me were the ones that I went to the most often this year. And for me, that's always like when I pick my best releases of the year, it's always the albums that I've listened to the most. They may not be absolutely perfect compared to others, but they're the ones that resonated with me the most. They're the ones that I went back to the most often, and they're the ones that probably going forward I will listen to more often. So coming in at, number 5? Yes, number 5 is a return from a band that I think we were all pretty upset when they announced they were breaking up a number of years ago, and they had decided to get back together. So Joe Bonamassa and Glenn Hughes went out to dinner. Decided, let's do this thing again. Let's write some material. Let's call Jason Bonham and Derek Sherinian back into play here. Let's put the band back together. I'm talking about Black Country Communion, BCC4. Fantastic album as always. You know, Glenn Hughes is just at 60 some odd years old, is still one of the best singers in hard rock, and he continues to amaze on this. Guy just gets better with age. You know, Bonamassa's guitar playing is awesome on here. Bonham is thundering away on the drums, and Derek Sherinian puts in a really good performance on this album. Great songs. Collide, Over My Head. The last song from My Resting Place, killer song, written by Bonamassa and sung by him. Sway is a great hard rocker. The Cove, for me, is probably one of the best songs in this album. It's in the tradition of like classic free, you know, Paul Rogers era free from way back in the day, but more importantly, the lyrical concept behind the song written by Glenn Hughes is all about the senseless slaughter of dolphins in that cove off of Japan that they do every year. And you know, it's one of those songs that, and I also am very against that whole event that they do every year, and as is Glenn. And when you kind of listen to the song, it's very chilling. It's kind of like a slow, heavy blues tune. And just listening to the lyrics, and if you're aware of, you know, what they do, it just brings a tear to my eye every time. It really gets me. So great album. A lot of other great tunes on here. When the Morning Comes, the Crow, Wanderlust, all good classic 70s style hard rock from a great band that I hope we continue to hear more from going forward. Okay, this next release coming in at number 4 was. Yeah, potentially in the top 1 or 2 for me. I love it to death. It's my favorite band of all time. Unfortunately, it got kind of nosed out a little bit. It came out pretty little earlier in the year, and just 3 just happened to come along that just kind of pushed it back ever so slightly, but I love it. It's called Infinite from Deep Purple. Great album. Once again, produced by Bob Ezrin, who did their last album as well. There's been talk that this might be their last studio album. They're on a big, long tour, worldwide tour. It's going to take about 2 years. I don't know. Even if they want to stop touring, because they've been, you know, on the road a lot over the last 15, 20 years, I hope they keep making albums, because their last couple of studio albums have just been terrific. So, of course, you know, Ian Gillan, Roger Glover, Ian Paice, Steve Morse, Don Airey. I love this album a lot. It's just vintage sounding Purple. Time for Bedlam, Hip Boots, Get Me Out of Here, The Surprising, Johnny's Band on Top of the World, Birds of Prey. The only song I don't really like on here is their remake of Roadhouse Blues. I would have rather heard another original tune. But otherwise, it's just a good, heavy rock album by legends who can still go crank it out there. So, coming in at number 4, Deep Purple's Infinite. All right, so number 3. This one kind of surprised the hell out of me. I had no idea these guys were coming out with a new album. It's been about 6 years since we've last seen them. And just all of a sudden one day showed up in my mailbox. I listen, and I always like these guys, but man, is this album great. I'm talking about the latest AFM release from Communic called Where Echoes Gather. This is epic stuff. They do a couple of little mini suites on here. Magnetics, Pulse of the Earth, two-parter, Where Echoes Gather, title track, two-parter, and then Claws of the Sea, two-parter. Just crushing progressive metal, but it's kind of atmospheric. It's dark. It's thrashy at times. For a three-piece, these guys have a full sound, amazing guitar work, great vocals, and just really interesting songs that are catchy, but they're dark. I just love this a lot. Really, really good album. Obviously, as you can see, one of the progressive metal hits of the year for me, Where Echoes Gather from Communic. Do not miss this one. All right, coming in at number 2. This actually, up until a couple of months ago, this was going to be my number 1 of the year. Again, like I said, and I've said year after year after year, usually my favorite release for me is the one that just resonated with me the most and prompted me to go back to more often than any other release of the year. And this has been out now, I think, 4 months, give or take, and I still listen to it often. For me, it's the best album they've done since Paradise Theater way back in the early 80s. It is a return to form for this band, who were always really good at doing combining like hard rock, progressive rock, and pop. This is a concept album, a sci-fi concept album written by Tommy Shaw. It's called The Mission by Styx. If you are a Styx fan of old, okay, we're talking, you know, Equinox, Pieces of Eight, Grand Illusion, Cornerstone, Crystal Ball, all that stuff, and you haven't picked this up yet, shame on you. Best album since that era. I'm telling you right now. Great songs. Almost every tune on here is extremely memorable. This is a pretty Tommy Shaw-dominated album, which for a lot of people, that'll be a good thing. And he's just, just classic songs on here. You know, Gone, Gone, Gone. Trouble with the Big Show, Locomotive, great song. Some really proggy stuff on here. Radio Silence, perhaps my favorite song on the album. Really, really catchy, great stuff. The Greater Good, what else we got here? 10,000 Ways, Red Storm, another great progressive rock type tune. Just really good. Great keyboards, great guitar work, vocals are off the charts. Again, this was my number one. It was going to be my number one until this bad boy came out. Another album that, you know, I remember when I first heard that this band was putting themselves together, kind of like a super group, I was like, kind of Sounds like a weird mix of folks there, but I was like, I'll give it a try, see what it's all about, you know? And then when I finally heard the whole album, it really just knocked me on my ass, and I'm still listening to it regularly every day. Well, maybe not every day, but pretty damn often. And it's just the more I listen to it, the more I like it. It's heavy. It's pretty complex at times. It's got great vocals, a lot of really cool, memorable hooks, okay? Anthems, keyboards are fantastic. The rhythms are great. Fantastic bass playing and drumming by two guys who have been working together for the last couple of years in a couple of different bands, and they're just really clicking on all cylinders. I'm talking about Sons of Apollo, Psychotic Symphony. That's that bad boy right there. I didn't expect to like this as much as I do. And I'm just really kind of psyched that this band decided to put, you know, these guys decided to form a band. Is there a picture of all of them together? Yeah, there we go. That's the guys. So, you know, you got Ron Thal, you got Mike Portnoy, you got Jeff Scott Soto on vocals, Derek Sherini on keyboards, and Mr. Billy Sheehan on bass. It's like, it's virtuoso, it's heavy. I never listened to Thal much as a guitar player. I heard bits and pieces here and there. Of course, he played with Guns N' Roses for a number of years, but he's just off the charts on here. Bone-crushingly heavy riffs, great complex shredding solos. Sherinian is off the charts here with his array of keyboards. Soto singing great as always, and Portnoy and Sheehan are just a monster of a rhythm team. So I just keep going back to it. So, you know, it took a lot to displace this, but this did it for me. But all these top 10, I've been listening to all these guys for a lot over the last, you know, bunch of months, or, you know, for some of them, most of the year. So can't recommend them enough. So that's it. That 2017 draws to a close. Those are my top 10 of the year. Like I said, if you want to see 11 through 20 and then 20 through 50, as well as my top live albums of the year, as well as my favorite guitar player, bass player, drummer, singer, keyboard player. They're all listed on the website along with all of our other writers from SOT on our main page at www.seatranquility.org. Visit us on Facebook. We are on, obviously, here on YouTube. We're on Twitter. And I know I said there was not going to be another new release show before the end of the year, but I actually have a stack of CDs that have come out real recently that I've just reviewed. I think I could squeeze one more show off before the first of the new year, so I'm going to do that over the next couple days, and I think I have one more rant left in me before the year ends. So be on the lookout for that this week. I'm actually off from work all week, so I can get all this stuff done, and I think I have a retrospective history of show on the mighty British heavy rock band UFO. So all that's coming this week, so I'm actually going to blast out a bunch of things for you this week before we take a little bit of a break for the early part of January 2018. So till then, make sure you investigate all this stuff, all my top picks here, because there's some really good stuff here, but there's so much, right? So anyway, hope everybody's having a wonderful Christmas, and have a happy new year, but you're going to see me before then. So till then, take care, peace out, enjoy the holidays, and we'll see you real soon.